Welcome back to this concluding session. In this session, I would go over to different remote centers to essentially request them to give me a feedback on the overall conduct of the workshop. Please keep your observations brief because I would like to go to as many remote centers as possible. I'm going to Shastra University now.
Namaste, sir. Sir, to give a clear feedback, first 2 days was really interesting and it was an eye-opener for us on various active learning strategies such as PR instruction, TPS, that is what we would like to say. But the last 2 days, the evening sessions we need to have something like active learning strategy that could have been done on those 2 days. But again, today it was really informative for us. Thank you very much. And at this gesture, we would like to thank Reader sir, Canada sir. And one more thing is, as long as we remember C++, we will also remember you, sir.
Well, thank you so much. We go to Truba College of Science and Technology.
Good morning, sir. This is Mehak Motwani from Truba College. Sir, this was a very good session, especially the active learning techniques that we were shared with, like think, pair and share and flipped classes. I was really hoping and believe that these learning will help us improve our lectures and make our student more interactive in the class sessions. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Truba. Walchin College of Engineering.
Hello, sir. Sir, the contents of the session are good morning session, but at the afternoon, the many faculties are from non-CSE background. That is, they are from electronics, mechanical. So, at the lab session, you must give the guidance for the practical.
So, yeah.
This is my opinion. Many found difficulties in conducting practical. That is for code block, how to run, how to execute two different files. Many find that if I am executing one file, then I close that. Then I open another file. Then at that time, it is executing previous file only. That is many of staff find difficulties.
Yeah.
Like there are small problems. We have solved that, but it is difficult to solve each and every thing. So if you give them guidance at the lab, then it is.
Thank you so much. I will clarify one thing, that this workshop was not meant to be a workshop on learning programming. This workshop was meant for teachers who are already teaching computer programming. And we mainly discuss different ways of teaching programming more effectively. So if some colleagues from mechanical and electronics, etc., have joined us, well, they are welcome. But I doubt whether they would benefit to a very large extent, because as I said, I had made it very clear in the brochure itself through an addendum that this is not a course in programming, this is not a workshop in programming. As far as code blocks is concerned, I think the mistake was not in our emphasizing that for every program you should actually start a new project and then run it. Unfortunately, code block has that kind of limitation in working, but the simplified version that we are preparing should help you out. Thank you so much for your comment. So we'll go to College of Engineering, Pune.
Sir, the question is, while teaching the programming language, how much trace should be given on the flowchart compared to the algorithm? And another question is, while writing this project activity, should we stick to the C++ or can we use mix of languages like say C along with the other language? So one more question my colleague want to ask you.
Good morning, sir. First, I would like to give my feedback about the session. It was really a wonderful session. The workshop helped us a lot by providing the active learning techniques, and the sample questions, or rather the sample course project material, whatever was given, was very helpful for us, and it made the idea was quite clear after reading all. But I wanted to ask, the whatever we are supposed to upload, the test questions and all, what is the due date for it, and is the only the team coordinator supposed to upload, and on what link?
So let me clarify first the question on flowchart and this. Personally, I don't believe that flowchart require any emphasis at all. In fact, after about 2 weeks, it should not be necessary for people to draw any flowcharts. Flowcharts are useful in the initial period just to explain some basic concepts such as sequence, conditional and iteration. After that, it is the textual writing with appropriate indentation, even in a pseudo language, which should suffice. The second question about the project is, the project per se is to be done by students to experiment and learn more about writing larger programs for the same course. So if the course uses C++, it is pertinent that they write their project also in C++. However, in so far as the teamwork is concerned, the project definition does not require, and I repeat this for all colleagues, it does not require the team to actually develop a project and submit. That is not at all the intention. The intention is merely identification of a project with, along with the title, give a brief description of what the functionality you expect and some more details as you can give. So this document is actually be meant for giving to the student teams later when we teach. It is the students who will actually develop that project. Of course, if some teams feel enthusiastic to write a complete project as a sample project, they are most welcome, but that is not expected as a part of this assignment. Secondly, you will notice that in my schedule thing yesterday, I had mentioned not only allocation of duties for different individuals to write a quiz problem or construct a test problem, etc. But there is also a review phase. In fact, all T6 tasks are review tasks. Somebody raised a question independently of what is this T6Q, etc., etc. The point is, if I set a quiz question, then I cannot automatically assume that the language used will be very correct, it will be easily understood, and the complexity will be correct to the level that is expected. So every question that I set or one sets should be cross-checked by someone else. That is the purpose of the review. The reviewer should therefore necessarily be different from the person who constructed that original material. And that is why every quiz question, every test question, every project description that is written by someone, obviously one person will write it, must be reviewed by someone else. Coordinator or the team leader is responsible for collecting and collating all these pieces in a single text file and upload it. There has to be exactly one submission from every team. So once the team leader submits it, it means that all the team members have submitted their assignment post-workshop. Yeah.
I have one question to you. That is, what amount of preparation and practice is required to convert the traditional classrooms into the flipped classrooms? The overall feedback is very good from all of the coordinators, my colleagues and all.
Yes.
The sessions were very interesting. Active learning strategies also very good. We got very positive points to make these things to happen in classrooms also. Now question is, how to convert these traditional classrooms into the flipped classrooms?
As I said, we have experimented with it, but the first major experiment that we'll be doing, I would say pilot, not even experiment, is when we run our CS 101 in the flipped classroom mode next semester. Now, a few things that occur to us is that the very design of the furniture in the classroom is not conducive for discussion. You look at the way you people are sitting. Now, at most, the discussion can happen among the three people who are sitting next to each other in a row. But if a row is too big, usually there should be round tables. Now, this is the modern classroom design, but these multiple round tables, etc., will take at least 5 to 10 years to come in our classrooms. Okay. But till then, more such pilots will give us an experience in doing things. In fact, I was expecting that the College of Engineering will also participate in our CS 101 flipped classroom, where students need not waste their time in listening to lectures in a classroom. Teachers need not waste their time in giving lectures, but can hold such flipped classroom discussion. Professor Sahasrabuddhi had asked me for it. We were not sure whether our platform will be ready to take up large load, but maybe within the next few days, I'll be writing to him as to the other heads of the institutions in case they are interested in joining us for this flipped classroom pilot. If that happens, then you will have that first-hand experience. But I will be able to tell something more authoritatively after I get a feedback from my own institute of handling about 600 students who do their CS 101 in the first semester. That feedback I'll be able to give in December. As I mentioned already, we will keep this Moodle alive. We'll keep this discussion forum alive. I will actually add a few more forums, and all of you should please feel free to both keep looking at the forum to see what others are saying and to add to it from your own experiences and thoughts. Thank you so much. BSA College of Engineering.
Sir, my question is this, how we can avoid it memory leakage problem in the programming?
I'm smiling because I have stopped consulting to industry in last 5 years completely to concentrate on this. But in all my life, wherever I used to handle the performance related problems in systems, memory leak used to be an extremely important cause of problems in most places. So the memory leak is avoided only by proper programming. And believe me, if you have a programming system consisting of some 1,000 programs, only 2 badly written programs are sufficient to bring the performance of the entire system crumbling down because somebody has not taken care of handling memory carefully. There is no universal solution. The only solution is fundamental discipline that if I malloc some memory, then I must deallocate it, and that my garbage collector should have an efficient algorithm to keep my memory as intact as possible in normal course. But there is no universal solution really. Just discipline is the solution. Thank you so much. EBT Group of Institutions.
Sir, we are very much satisfied with the code blocks development environment you have given for us. In fact, it reminds me of Microsoft Visual Studio development environment. It is similar to that. A very wonderful development experience with this code block. But is there any flavor or version available for open source? Code block for open source, sir?
Code blocks is open source.
Of course, sir.
Yeah.
Whether it is architecture neutral or platform independent, will I be able to work with the Ubuntu or Unix, sir?
Yes.
Linux?
In IIT Bombay, the code blocks is used on Ubuntu environment because we have only universally Ubuntu environment only. We don't have Microsoft environment in our labs. But it works on Microsoft, it also works on Ubuntu without any problem. It is not meant for the back-end, high-end servers kind of environment. It is meant actually as a front-end tool to be installed on a personal PC or something. So do not expect programs of 20,000 lines or more or programming systems to work smoothly on that because the backend, the PC itself will not have sufficient capacity. But in general, whatever we have tried, very large programs also work correctly on it. So that's not a problem. I'm happy that you like that environment and use it. I hope you'll use it further. Thank you. OP Jindal Institute of Technology.
Good morning, sir. I am Asankaran Dandopat. My question is, what is the basic difference between function and method? Because in object-oriented programming like Java, we call it as method, and in case of C++ or C language, we call it function. What is the basic difference? How we
interesting question. First of all, the entire approach to programming is different. In object-oriented programming, you deal with objects and classes. And the methods that we speak about are actually member functions which are defined along with the class. In C, the functions which you define are defined for general use. It is a traditional way of invoking a pre-written procedure. Anybody can call any function from anywhere. Functions are not specific to only a group of activity. The member functions, on the other hand, in object-oriented programming, have a tag. They are always tagged to certain class. So as long as you are interacting with that class, you use those member functions. The basic feature is same, namely, you go to a code written by someone else somewhere else, you go there with some parameters, and you bring back certain results. In C, you would call it function. In C++, the method is slightly different, because what are parameters here are actually slightly more, not complex, but they're handled differently. You see, you look at the way that data is handled in objects is significantly different. An object is instantiated. In C, memory is almost always pre-allocated unless you use advanced concepts like malloc and so on. Okay. Whereas in an object-oriented environment, the moment you actually invoke an object, it is instantiated and it is created. The memory allocation is almost always dynamic in an object-oriented environment. But as regards functions and methods, the approach is different. They attempt to do the same thing. In my opinion, it is better not to let our students compare the two. Our students should know how to write a function independently while studying procedural programming. And when they go to object-oriented programming, they should look at the methods as methods, not a avatar of function. Because those methods are, as I said, those are member functions generally of a class. I hope that answers your question. We are going to Jawaharlal Nehru National College.
The program is good enough, but actual implicability is little doubtful. Rather than that, sometimes we thought that if you allow students to carry laptops into the classroom, and when you are teaching the programming, if you ask them to execute then and there, maybe they'll do that. But one day before them keeping time for the subject in the evening,
students carrying their laptop to the classroom, there is a mixed feeling amongst teachers. Some teachers feel that let students carry the laptops to the classroom, there is absolutely no problem. Of course, if you have a Wi-Fi connection, what they are doing on the laptop during the class is a matter of speculation. They are not necessarily doing what you want them to do, they might be doing something else. There are, on the other hand, there are several classrooms where classrooms and labs are combined. And the students actually sit on the machines while listening to the lecture. And the lecture involves a whole lot of active learning at intermittent places where students are told to try out some program, compile it, run it. Then some modification is suggested by the teacher. Often there is a 5-minute common explanation. For programming kind of courses, that environment is good. As far as laptop in a class is concerned, the problem is not all students in my class will have laptops, and that could cause a problem. But I think a view has to be taken by individual teachers. It is very difficult to generalize. You had apparently some more part of the question, so please go ahead and ask.
Yeah. So what I meant was they could carry, let us say, alternative students can carry, or two per bench, just to generate interest, and I was specific that this is to be applied to programming languages classes only, not
yes.
for all the classes.
Yes.
So if we generate like that, maybe that will take care of it. That was my.
I agree with you. I agree with you. Thank you very much for your feedback. Let's go over to 1324, Siliguri Institute of Technology. We met them only yesterday, but doesn't matter. You're so far away from us that it is a pleasure to talk to you twice. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, sir. For technology, we are very near, and we really are here to give you the feedback. Above all, we really liked your question answer handling session. You really managed it in an outstanding way. We eagerly want to learn how to handle the question answering session with the students in your way. Regarding the workshop, the program direct to the program argument passing was not understandable by us. The knowledge passing session related to the string and pointer could be more in depth. Hemachandra example was excellent for the recursion. We really think some modification needed in the workshop content. For example, the last presentation was excellent, and that could be available in all presentation. We really think that it is very difficult to implement active learning session in our institute, since we have very strict deadline to complete the syllabus. So it is excellent method of teaching. Apart from all, we are also enriched by observing you and your dedication, enthusiasm, energy, which should be the hallmark any aspiring teacher. Thank you, sir.
And thank you so much for your compliments, and thanks for your suggestion of modifying the contents appropriately. We take note of it. Introducing active learning is difficult, as you rightly mentioned, is because of the strict timetable that you have. But you see, the timetable is also set by us only. Now it's a question that we should ask whether, because some syllabus is fixed for a semester, should we run after completing that syllabus, or should we say it does not matter if a few topics are not covered in the syllabus, but whatever is covered is better understood by students through using techniques such as active learning and whatever. So this battle is going to continue for some time. Unfortunately, the syllabus setting and the system of exam setting is not in the hands of teachers like us. It is often decided by university administration and the boards of study. I am only hoping that many of teacher colleagues who are participating in this workshop are members of such boards, and they will get these ideas back there, and hopefully the system will revamp itself over the next 3 to 5 years' time. So let us hope for the best. Thank you so much for your inputs. This is National Institute of Science and Technology, Orissa.
Morning, sir. My question is, yesterday you had explained about files programming. In that file programming, you have mixed both the C files concept as well as C++ files concept. If we suppose to explain this kind of concept to the student, I think it will the total confusion to the student. So what kind of precaution should be taken? This is my first question. Second question, between the C files handling as well as C++ file handling, which one is the efficient? So that ultimately we can reach the students in a proper way. My second question, sir.
To answer your question, I did not actually pick the C++ syntax. You will recall that if I am using a pure C++ way of handling things, I will actually define a I stream and O stream and so on. The only difference is that I had used IO stream because of the C++ usage. But all programs which I have written and the functions which are used for fopen, fclose, fread, fwrite, etc., etc., are all available under the normal C compiler. You don't need a C++ environment. So the sample programs which I have given will work perfectly on C. You will have to include an appropriate header file. That is the only difference. There is one more question by the lady next to you. Maybe I'll spend 1 minute in the... By the way, none of you is telling us your name. I think it would be nice for the thousands of people to know a few people by name. Yeah, over to you.
As you have told, Ki, this is a pure C++. Before learning C++, it is not necessary to learn C. That is the only question here. Though you have mixed both C and C++, how would you go to the student in an efficient way, Ki? You go either go with either C function way, file programming way, or C++ files programming way.
Okay. Let me try and explain this once again. While I called it C++, I did not use C++ object-oriented facilities at all. For example, if I were to write programs in a pure C++ way, I'll be actually using the standard template library. The standard template library is a very rich library which permits variety of functions. I had used the normal C functions and the normal C programming way, only calling it C++, so that when they transition to C++, it is very easy for them. The idea is not to tell them that C and C++ are very different. We call it C++, but what we teach is a procedural programming. I was aware of the fact that 60% of our colleges in the country actually teach C programming in their first course by design. That is what is stipulated in their syllabus. So they must be able to use the material that we cover in such workshops. They should be able to do that. They will call it C instead of C++, that's all. So I think there's one more question that the lady was raising hand. I'll take that quickly and go to the next remote center. Over to you.
My question is there are so many compilers, why do we took the C++ code blocks?
We have to choose something, and we have to choose something that is simple, and we have to choose something that can be used not only by 8,000 teachers who are registered for this workshop, but by 8 lakh students who learn programming every year. If I choose any other environment, there are many good programming environments which are proprietary, but they all cost money. An open source tool can be legally downloaded and used by anybody, and that is the reason to use this.
Is lead binding is possible in C? If yes, then how? If no, then why?
The lead binding and such binding related issues should not at all be discussed in the first course. They just do not make sense. Please appreciate that. The binding refers to binding of your data items that you have in your program with the backend environment. In fact, you will notice that concepts of dynamic memory allocation are often not taught in the first course. And that is, the purpose is precisely to keep things simple for the first course. Someday, we will have an advanced course on programming where I will be very glad to answer those questions. But right now, my answer is, please avoid talking about it to your students, lest you confuse them. And if your university has such notions of lead binding as a part of their syllabus, please go back and get the syllabus modified. I don't think it is worth it to discuss those issues. SKN College, Sinhagad.
Good morning, sir. I'm very much thankful for this workshop, arranging the workshop by you. That is the session which has been conducted by active learning strategies, which are very, very essential nowadays. As well as the trace which always IIT is given for the open source, which is also very important for the our colleges. Sir, we also learned that how to teach the programming languages. So we know the knowledge of detailed knowledge about the program, but the way of express and the way of is very, very excellent. Here for the one of the information I want to give that. They are having electronics as well as mechanical faculties in our workshop, and they are also learn that the importance of this way of expression and then how to handle the and how to teach the students. Sir, my one question is that related to Akash tablets, that we want to take the cues on Akash tablet locally, not remotely. So for that, how we can conduct the queues on Akash tablet locally in an Akash server we want to upload our questions in Akash server. So that we want to be do by our side, but we are not getting how to do it.
Yes, thank you so much for your comments, and as regard Akash tablets, and I hope that such confusion does not exist amongst colleagues in other remote centers which are our Akash centers. The very objective of designing this clicker application on Akash is to enable every college to locally conduct such quizzes. All that you need to do is go to the akashlabs.in site, go to the clicker application and look at the documentation. It tells you how you can download the main server side software. Incidentally, all that is open source. So load that on your server, and then it will automatically give you a teacher's interface where you can feed in your quizzes and you can conduct quizzes in your classes. That's the very objective, and that is already there. Perhaps because you were interacting with our team only in terms of conducting remote quizzes, this might not have been mentioned, but that is the very crux of our entire open source development, that every college, every institution, every teacher should be able to use that. As a matter of fact, it should be possible for a teacher to load this server and software on his or her PC and independently conduct a test in a Wi-Fi connected environment without even waiting for a local area network and a large framework. But ideally, you should install it on your server. It is possible to do so.
If we have such kind of workshop for in the image processing, then it will be better for the computer science people understand it.
I have been requesting my colleagues such as Professor Vikram Gadre and Professor Subhashish to come forward and conduct a workshop like this. Probably they are scared of addressing 10,000 people at a time. I will again request them. Professor Vikram Gadre has already conducted a workshop on signals and systems. I think he is very comfortable. Maybe this December or next summer we'll do that. Thank you. This is Nagole Institute of Technology.
Yeah, good morning, sir. This is from Nagole Institute of Technology, RC is 1296. And regarding the program, it was very interesting, and also because, I mean, within a coming short week, we are getting into a new academic year, which help us how to give more understanding to the students about various concepts and also various design principles about this, I mean, by learning from this workshop. And my question is here, in why we do the programming in C++, I mean, compiling errors or something like a logical errors will be come across while programming. Is there any specific tool to address all those problems, something like not in within the language, but any other extensively we can use that tool? Like something like, suppose for example, if we go for a MATLAB programming, so it's basically it addressed the mathematical applications in programming aspects. Similarly, in this C++ computer programming, if there are any specific tool, it will help us more efficiently to solve the bugs or logical errors.
Unfortunately not. I get your answer. I get your question. Unfortunately, what we are discussing is introducing programming to first year students, and that limited thing, I think the environment that we talk of like code blocks is sufficient. What you are mentioning like MATLAB is an application package. The only corresponding thing to MATLAB that I know of is a package called Scilab, which is an open source package, which does exactly what MATLAB is capable of, but is open source and free. So you might try that for solving the kind of problem that you're mentioning. C programming language is meant to be used by programmers to write programs to solve such problems. So one should not expect an environment which runs C programs to be able to solve problems. That is our job. In fact, you might want to talk to your colleagues in your center and find out if any one of them would be interested in suggesting a course project describing development of such an application. Such course projects cannot obviously be done by a 3-student or 4-student team, but a larger team should be able to do that. Other than that, I would like you to only remember, I'll reiterate, that a first course in programming is what we are discussing, And in the first course in programming, the effort is to ensure that our students learn the basics of programming. The larger solution building packages, etc., will hopefully come later. Thank you so much.
Yeah, and one more thing, I mean, a little bit extension to that question. If I look forward, I mean, something more courses in computer programming, because I mean, now the students must be industry ready after the completion of their BTech courses, like something like a training in Linux programming and also something like other operating systems. So I look forward this type of workshops in the various courses. I mean, it's in a near shorter span.
I would like to ask you a counter question. It's a very good suggestion, by the way, and we have been toying with this idea. The point is that the government funding is limited only to conduct these workshops, and even government has told us to go over to a model of self-financing kind of workshops from 2015 onwards. Now we are toying with the idea of conducting workshops spread over, say, a month or so, but conducted on Saturday, Sunday. Now if we conduct workshops on topics such as Linux or any advanced programming, or for that matter in any other field also, but on Saturday, Sunday, and if we announce the timetable that this Saturday, Sunday, these workshops will be held over 3 consecutive Saturday, Sundays or 4 consecutive Saturday, Sundays, of course we will not be able to easily accommodate people who stay away from that town or city, but at least in 300 remote centers, these will not be funded workshops. These workshops will have to be organized by the colleges for their students and teachers, and local expenditure has to be met by the colleges themselves. So I will take this feedback to be a generic suggestion on behalf of the entire academic fraternity collected here, and I will talk to my colleagues whether in the regular semesters we could have such well-designed and well-defined few courses on some advanced topics to be conducted on Saturday, Sunday, and to be joined by those colleges which are interested in doing that on their own. But we will still follow the normal registration process and so on. We may or may not be able to issue any certificates at the end, but as our colleague suggested from that center, that many students and teachers may benefit from such an endeavor, and we'll be very glad to do that definitely. We'll go to Marathwada Institute.
Good morning, sir. Myself Shubhashree Savant, RC1098. First of all, I want to thank you and your team for conducting a workshop on how to teach computer programming effectively. Since we all are on average teaching this subject from 5 years, but from these workshops we learn so many new things like active learning, flipped classrooms, and even how to teach using turtle programming, using simple CPP, basic concepts. And I assured you, sir, that we are going to use these techniques in our classes. One more thing I want to share, that ours is the we are using the spoken tutorial as well, and recently we received the award for conducting spoken tutorial series as well as spreading the spoken tutorial, and we are also interested in contributing in the spoken tutorial which is going to be for the CS 101. Thank you, sir.
Very good, Professor Savant. I will remember this offer of your contribution to CS101X, and we'll get back to you on the spoken tutorial like construct. There is one more question that your colleague wants to ask.
Good afternoon, sir. Myself Ravi Kumte. First of all, I appreciate you and your team for taking such effort for arranging the workshop and for your energy delivering the lecture. We learned so many things about computer programming, about flipped classroom, this activity, tricks to solve problems, setting quizzes and test questions, idea about active learning, which we assure we definitely implement in our teaching. We also thank you and your team for effort you have taken for effective teaching method. Sir, I have one question again. University conducted examination in described format. What do you think? It is better to improve knowledge, practical knowledge of student as per industry required,
university exam pattern need to undergo a lot of change. You are very right, industry is looking for people who actually understand programming and can write large programs very quickly. Industry is not particularly interested in what syllabus you have and what examination pattern you have. It is for us and our universities to ensure that we change the syllabus, we change the teaching style, and we change the exam style such that our students are better prepared. Unfortunately, I am too remote and too small a person to change the university kind of thing. But since you are talking about a university in your region, it should be possible for you and your colleagues and from other colleagues in the remote centers of Marathwada to go and have a discussion with your board of studies to suggest some changes in the approach in which this subject is expected to be taught and evaluated. But I will tell you one more thing. Independent of the scheme of evaluation and independent of the syllabus, it is actually possible to let at least those students who are interested in learning real programming to learn better. And this technique requires some more work by both teachers and students. The technique is as follows. You say the normal classes and labs will continue to teach what is required to pass the examinations of the university. But additionally, we will hold special labs on Saturdays and Sundays and special discussion sessions. Those who are interested may come. There will be no discussion on the syllabus or exam related question. We will only discuss programming problems. We will together write some large programs. I have seen such groups being established of students and teachers in many colleges who meet regularly on a weekend outside the classroom, outside the syllabus, and discuss these problems. I will tell you from my experience that such students do very well in the industry after they pass out, because they have really tried to write some large programs and learn the true programming concepts rather than studying only for passing the exam. So this is my suggestion. Within the normal university system, you will be able to do something if the university system itself changes. So replace all written examinations, for example, that the university insists on, by internal examinations, where you conduct examinations every week and accumulate the marks. That is what we do in IIT system, that is what you should be able to do in your system as well. But that will take slightly longer. It's not an easy battle. Okay, we'll take one more question because our friend in the left corner is desperate to ask a question. He's kept his hand raised for a long time. Over to you.
Good morning, sir. I just want to ask, we have different kind of students in the class, like those who are good at programming, those who are not good at programming, and few are very scared about maths, mathematics, and all these things. So is it a good approach to introduce mathematics kind of thing for those students while teaching for the first time?
The examples that a teacher selects will generally have to factor in the background of the students. But one thing I can tell you, that those students who are poor in programming or those students who are scared, they are so because they are not willing to leave fear aside and try out things. There is absolutely nothing great in computer programming that at least the basic concepts cannot be learned by all people. If the background differs, then the background can be compensated by having some additional discussion sessions, etc. But the most important thing is what you just said. It is the fear. They are scared. You remove their scare, and I will tell you, whatever be their background and intellectual competence, with the same competence they can achieve 5 times more than what they achieve with a scared attitude. So I try to address the attitude, try to keep telling them not to fear, not to worry at all, but keep practicing. Tell them the great advantage of a computer. You see, if you make a mistake, a human being shouts back at you. A computer does not shout back. It only gives error messages. So they should feel very comfortable and happy working on the computer. The only thing is they have to try. What happens with our students is, if something does not work in the first attempt, then they sort of give up. Second, they want very precise specification of what they should do in the lab. So, log in the account, do this, type this in, do this, run this program, and when everything works correctly, submit it. That does not encourage creativity or learning. You must give them open-ended problems. You must give little explanation to begin with. Let them discover things. Let them make mistakes. But be available to help. So the strategy in a lab, for example, should be that give some initial instructions, then let them play around for half an hour. Then go around and keep helping them wherever people have problems. That way they will learn faster, is my own experience. Thank you so much. Let's go over to, this is Jnanamani College of Engineering.
I am very much thankful for you and your team for conducting this set of workshop. And it's really very nice, sir. The sessions such as active learning and TPUs are really good and it's very useful for us. And my question is that most of the students are really examination oriented. Do you believe that the active learning and TPS techniques are much effective if you are implementing in our engineering colleges?
It's a good question. The point is, we do not know. But how will we know unless we try? So it is a chicken and egg story. Because there is a conventional system of education that is going on, and the active learning prima facie does not appear to help students pass the examination, we may hesitate in inducting that system. But if we never do it, how will we know whether it is effective or not? Let me put it this way. Passing examinations with good marks has always been the intention of all students. It was so 50 years ago with me and my batch, it is so today. It might appear to be heightened to you, but that is always the fundamental objective of a student, to pass exams and get good marks. Now, why is it not possible for us to actually introduce active learning in such a manner that the students also eventually are helped in getting better marks in their exams? It all depends upon not the method of teaching, but the kind of examples that we choose and the kind of work that we force students to do. If we use active learning and flipped classroom with the right kind of examples, I am sure it will definitely help. Try out my idea of giving people take-home tests. Believe me, it takes only your effort in setting up the test paper and setting up model answers. Rest of it is done by student. If you give such quizzes and tests take-home, say 4 times in a semester, your students will automatically get better marks in their examinations because that is the kind of sample problem that they will be attempting. Students learn, even for examinations, by reading books. If they understand, by writing more programs, they learn better and they get better marks, they will definitely do that also. In short, don't be hesitant. Try out active learning techniques. To begin with, at least try it out in first couple of weeks. If the students get interested, you can continue with that approach, simultaneously ensuring that students learn enough to pass their courses with good marks also. In short, good teaching learning and getting good marks in examination are not contradictory things. It is not this or that, but I think both should be possible. Thank you so much. Let's go over to Team College of Engineering.
Hello, sir. I want to ask you one question. Engineering, STR-TPY, how much memory
I think I will not answer this question because it can simply be answered by running string copy in multiple instances. I will suggest one thing. Give a large string from which you are copying to a smaller string. Give parameters which are different, and then you will see what happens automatically. So it's a very, in ordinary circumstances, string copy should be used to copy specified portion of a string into the target string where you know for sure that there is appropriate place available for accommodating the source string characters. But exactly what happens depends upon the sizes of the arrays that you have defined, the size of the number of bytes that you have defined for the transfer. There are a few default parameters and there are a few additional parameters that you can write. My suggestion is just simply read the C++ documentation for not only this but for all functions. Many times what happens is that there is a function which has multiple parameters. Some of those parameters have default value, and we teach our students only to use those functions with default value. But if you explain that these are the full set of parameters and you can actually control the behavior of the function more precisely by giving those parameters and some specific values, then that will help. I would suggest you try that out with not only this but all other functions. Thank you so much. Narayana Engineering College, over to you.
Good morning, sir. I have a question. While accepting the data members of a structure, for example, student number, student name, fees, when we using get function reading the members of structure, it skips the function of char. Why?
No. I don't. It does not skip. It is the order in which I am giving values. That is the order I have decided in my program, but you can write that program differently. It is not skipping, it is reading. You will have to give that data. If you execute that program, you will see that no data member is missed. For every struct variable, which is part of the array of students or whatever, for every student, for example, you are definitely reading all the values. It is for us to take care of these things in our program. And you can write the program in various ways. For example, you might have default values for certain fields. Let's say there is a batch of students whose data you are inputting and all students are from the same lab batch. Then you need not read that data from input at all. You can define S dot batch to be something and keep that intact and change only the other members. So it all can be controlled by your input statement. There is nothing like skipping something that will ever happen, but if you skip some data, you will skip it because you have not assigned that data. Otherwise, there is no problem with the programming language syntax. Maybe there is an error in the program that I have uploaded. I do not think so because I have run that program and it ran properly. It created the binary file which I inspected. So just cross-check again. Dr. Mahalingam College of Engineering. Over to you.
Sir, my question is regarding Moodle. How can we add up questions in a different format using different plugins in Moodle?
Oh, questions in different format. Now, that's a major problem because in one of the workshops, I collected such similar things from participants and the number of formats I had to deal with at the end was not funny. So some people used their my Word file, some people submitted PDF, some people submitted something else. The reason I have said is that you should stick to a text file only is because a plain text file is easily analyzed automatically. Please remember that the format that our team has prepared and uploaded, in which you have to give your entire details, is actually going to be read and analyzed automatically. There is a backend program system which is being written here, which will take your text file and automatically separate out, for example, the simple quiz question of that topic from all submissions, medium quiz question from that topic for all submissions, etc. And to automate that process, we require submission in plain text only. Anything which is not text is not easily searchable by the program that would write. That is the reason. There is no other reason. PSG College of Technology, Coimbatore.
Good morning, sir. The workshop was very useful and the pedagogy sessions were very useful. We also attended pedagogy over QEEE. My suggestion is, if the pedagogy is related only to computer programming, it will be very much useful. So you can conduct another workshop which is related to pedagogy with computer science and computer programming.
Thank you so much. There is one more question, yes.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Malavika from GCT, sir.
Your session is very good, sir. Actually, I would like to thank the MHRD and IIT Bombay to conduct this event, sir. When I used to take the classes, I used to take the examples, very simple examples. But in the case you took the Hemachandra problem, Riemann integral, and magic squares, these are all very helpful for me to handle the session, sir. And the thing is, your Budhuram Dumbo, it is very excellent application, sir. Because why I am saying this is, actually the students will have the problem conceptually to view the memory handling, how the program is going to handle the memory real scenario. So you have explained that concept very superb, sir. I'll use this in my class. Thank you.
Thank you. You're most welcome. Incidentally, as our introductory lectures get ready for CS101X, most of the video recorded lectures, as I mentioned, IIT Bombay has permitted me and has decided, in fact, that most of our lectures, lecture videos and problems, etc., will be released in open source. So the moment they get tested once through the global students, we will do the final editing and release them not only in open source, but I'll keep all colleagues informed so that if they wish, they can use either the video lectures or the examples, etc., etc., in their own classes. In fact, one of the important ideas here is that all the work that you are going to do, it may be officially being done for the assignments, for example, the team assignment that you submit. But the idea is that all of us should benefit. So just as our lady friend liked my Dumbo, many of you may come up with some very good examples in the form of quiz problems or test problems, which all of us would like to share and use. So I'm happy about this. We'll continue doing that. Thank you so much. DMETR Varda, is there someone to give a feedback for this workshop? Over to you, Varda.
Sir, I was having question regarding project. You told to submit project based on any one topic which we will select, but you didn't told us ki, what will be the span of completing that project for students. Will it be a 1 week project or 2 week project or a 3 week project?
Okay, let me again clarify. I think I will put an explanatory note on the Moodle today itself. Please understand that the project has nothing to do with the topic that is allocated. A project is not done on a topic, never done on a topic. I think I gave this explanation, and I will request all colleagues in all remote centers to listen to this very carefully. The team activity project definition that you are giving has absolutely nothing to do with the topic that has either been allocated to you or to any other. A project is a general purpose activity of building computer programs that the students are expected to do over 2 months period in their regular course. And all that the teachers are doing is they are thinking of project ideas of what projects can be given to the student. These project ideas obviously have nothing to do with individual topics such as iteration or matrices or something like that. Those topics are a separate thing. Those 10 topics are listed and allocated for all participating teams to set quiz questions and test questions. Project is a completely independent thing. This project is expected to be a team project of the kind that I had described in one of the sessions, which students will do on their own later. So be guided by the sample project documentation that I have uploaded. It is that kind of documentation that students will be preparing and giving. All that you need to do right now is to define a title of the project, a functional description of what the student should attempt to achieve, what kind of program they should write to achieve that, and some details about that. That's all is expected. So I hope that clarifies the doubt.